In a dim laboratory in Salt Lake City during the 1930s, witnesses claim to have seen something impossible. Thomas Henry Moray, an electrical engineer and a follower of Nikola Tesla's work, flipped a switch, and banks of light bulbs blazed to life, motors hummed, and radiant heat filled the room. The device before them was silent, had no moving parts, no visible fuel source, and no electrical connection to any grid. Moray said it was powered by a cosmic sea of energy that flowed constantly through all space, an inexhaustible source waiting to be tapped. He called it radiant energy, describing it as finer than electricity and more penetrating than radio waves. He insisted the universe itself was alive with this invisible current and that his machine could convert it into usable power. According to witnesses, the output was astonishing. Tens of kilowatts pouring from a small box of coils, capacitors, and vacuum tubes. To those who saw it, the device defied every known law of physics, and to Moray, it was the key to humanity's liberation from fossil fuels forever. Thomas Henry Moray was born in Salt Lake City, Utah, in 1892, into a time of rapid scientific discovery. From an early age, he showed a fascination with electricity and wireless communication. As a teenager, he built his own radio receivers and began experimenting with antennas and crystal detectors. By the time he graduated from college, his interests had already turned toward the mysteries of unseen energy in the universe. In the early 1920s, while working as an electrical engineer, Moray began developing an unusual hypothesis inspired by the works of Nikola Tesla. He believed that the space surrounding Earth was filled with a form of latent energy, what he called radiant energy. It was, in his view, the same cosmic force that powered the stars and could be converted into usable electricity. He imagined the universe as a sea of endless vibration, and if he could find the right kind of material, he might capture and transform this energy into current. His first experiments used ordinary radio components. Moray built tuned circuits with coils, capacitors, and crystal detectors, similar to those used in early wireless receivers. But he noticed strange effects. Certain combinations of metals and minerals produced measurable currents, even when no signal was being transmitted. These findings convinced him that he had stumbled upon something that defied conventional explanation. In his notebook, he wrote that he had tapped the energy of the cosmos itself. By 1925, Moray had assembled what he claimed was the first working prototype of his radiant energy device. It consisted of an antenna, grounding wires, and a sealed glass tube he called the valve. This tube, he said, was the key to the entire process. It captured high-frequency oscillations from space and converted them into direct electrical power. He performed small demonstrations for colleagues, lighting bulbs without visible power sources. Some dismissed it as a trick, but others left puzzled, unable to explain what they had seen. Around 1926, Moray attempted to patent his invention. The United States Patent Office rejected the application on the grounds that the device had no identifiable energy source. Patent examiners insisted that perpetual motion was impossible, and Moray's explanation of cosmic energy sounded too much like it. He revised the application, but it was denied again. The rejections only strengthened his belief that established authorities refused to acknowledge discoveries that threatened conventional industries. During the late 1920s, he continued refining his invention, improving its stability and output. He wrote a manuscript titled Beyond the Light Rays, later expanded into The Sea of Energy, in which the Earth floats, in which he described the theoretical foundation for his work.
The Sea of Energy in Which the Earth Floats was a revolutionary book written by T. Henry Moray, an electrical engineer and Tesla enthusiast who in the early 20s began working on a device he claimed intercepted radiant energy from outer space. His solid-state detector, the Moray valve, was designed with a complex series of semiconductors, high-voltage capacitors, and transformers hooked up to an antenna and a ground wire. By stimulating the existing oscillations of space energy, his radiant energy device ran for days, putting out 50 kilowatts of electricity. His public demonstrations attracted newspaper coverage and scientists from Bell Laboratories and the Department of Agriculture's Rural Electrification Administration. Although no one could find evidence of fraud, neither could anyone explain how the radiant energy device worked.
He argued that space was saturated with streams of subatomic energy that could be converted by materials tuned to their natural frequencies. His writing blended technical theory with philosophical conviction, claiming that energy was the divine essence of creation. In 1931, Moray held a public demonstration that drew both curiosity and controversy. He set up his equipment far from power lines, connected the antenna and ground, and threw the switch. To the astonishment of witnesses, bright incandescent lamps flickered to life. The machine ran silently for nearly an hour, producing enough power to light a small house. Skeptical engineers inspected the wires but found no batteries, dynamos, or hidden generators. When they asked for an explanation, Moray simply said, "It comes from the air." News of the demonstration spread quickly across Utah. Journalists wrote sensational stories about free power from the cosmos, and curious investors began visiting his lab. Among them were representatives from power companies and government agencies who wanted to understand or control what he had built. Moray refused to sell his patent rights or reveal the full details of his circuit. He feared that any large corporation would suppress the discovery to protect its existing business. His refusal soon made him enemies. In 1933, he was invited to demonstrate the device again for officials and scientists from Washington, D.C. He agreed, but insisted on keeping parts of the circuit sealed for proprietary reasons. The demonstration took place in his Salt Lake City laboratory. Once again, lights glowed and instruments recorded electrical current. But when the visitors requested a disassembly for inspection, Moray declined. They left unconvinced, and the official report concluded that the source of the power was undetermined. The same year, tragedy struck when Moray's laboratory was vandalized. Unknown intruders smashed equipment, tore apart notes, and destroyed several of his special valves. Moray later claimed that one of the men had come under the guise of friendship, but had tried to steal the secret formula for the tube. During the confrontation, the intruder allegedly fired a gun, shattering the main device. The story became part of the legend surrounding him, but no police record ever confirmed the details. What is certain is that the destruction set him back years. In the mid-1930s, Moray attempted to rebuild his apparatus from memory and surviving components. He experimented with different materials, including germanium, bismuth, and uranium salts, searching for the exact combination that had worked before. He succeeded in reproducing partial effects but could not achieve the same power levels as before the destruction. Frustrated, he grew increasingly secretive, limiting access even to assistants and family members. His once promising research began to stall. During this period, Moray's mental and emotional state began to deteriorate. He became convinced that his work was being actively suppressed. He claimed that representatives of oil companies and government agencies had approached him with offers to buy his patents only to bury them. He told associates that his mail was being opened and his house watched. Whether paranoia or genuine harassment, these beliefs shaped his later life and deepened his mistrust of authority.
Unfortunately, as all too many inventors have suffered, when he refused to sell out to powerful interests, Moray and his family were threatened, shot at, and their laboratory ransacked. Ignored by the U.S. Patent Office, Moray quietly stopped public disclosure of the device after it was destroyed by his assistant, Felix Frazier, a communist sympathizer who was frustrated when Moray declined his repeated offers to take that technology to Russia.
By 1939, his relationship with the scientific establishment was all but destroyed. He published more of his theories independently, arguing that mainstream physics was built on flawed assumptions. He compared the suppression of radiant energy to the persecution of early innovators like Galileo. He wrote that humanity was enslaved by ignorance and greed, and that true progress required freeing energy from the chains of commerce. His words appealed to a small group of followers who saw him as a visionary ahead of his time. World War II temporarily shifted public focus away from alternative energy research. Moray offered his services to the government, suggesting that his radiant energy principles could enhance communication or power systems. The offers were ignored. Instead, he found work designing radio and therapeutic devices, one of which eventually earned him a legitimate patent in 1949. Though unrelated to his energy machine, it was a small victory in a career overshadowed by rejection. In the post-war years, Moray continued to refine his ideas while becoming increasingly isolated. He maintained that his earlier device had worked exactly as claimed, producing up to 50,000 watts of clean power directly from space. He blamed its suppression on what he called the energy cartels that ruled modern society. In his lectures, he described a world where every home could draw power from the atmosphere, eliminating pollution and poverty. Audiences listened with fascination, but few believed. The 1950s saw renewed interest in atomic energy and nuclear physics, but Moray's theories remained outside the scientific mainstream. He began to connect his work to broader metaphysical ideas, arguing that radiant energy was a bridge between matter and spirit. He described the universe as a vast harmonic system and claimed that his device resonated with these cosmic frequencies. For him, the discovery was not just technological, it was spiritual proof that energy and consciousness were one. In the 1960s, Moray's health began to decline, but he continued to lecture and write. He warned that the world's dependence on fossil fuels would lead to crisis, and that his suppressed invention could have prevented it. His followers tried to persuade him to release the full schematics before it was too late, but he refused, fearing they would be misused or destroyed again. As his body weakened, his conviction remained unshaken. He told his son that one day, the sea of energy would be rediscovered by minds ready to accept it. Moray died in 1974, taking with him the precise composition of the mysterious valve that had powered his device. His papers and prototypes were inherited by his son, John Moray, who dedicated decades to reconstructing the machine.
I am John E. Moray, the son of T. Henry Moray. Nikola Tesla said, "There is energy throughout space," that this energy was kinetic, and that it would be only a matter of time when men would hitch their machinery to the very will work of nature. My father, T. Henry Moray, did his work and discovered this energy.
John claimed partial success, producing small but measurable power outputs from ambient sources. Yet the original performance, lighting banks of bulbs with no external input, was never duplicated. Without the master valve, the secret remained buried in obscurity. After his death, the legend of Thomas Henry Moray grew. Free energy enthusiasts cited his work as proof that clean, limitless power had once been achieved and then silenced. Conspiracy theorists linked his suppression to the same hidden forces said to have buried Tesla's work. Skeptics, meanwhile, pointed to the absence of documentation and the lack of independent verification. They argued that Moray's demonstrations were likely misunderstood radio effects or even deliberate deception. The debate continues to this day. In modern times, some researchers have revisited Moray's claims in light of quantum theory and zero-point energy. While mainstream physics confirms that vacuum energy exists, it also holds that it cannot be extracted in any practical way. To Moray's supporters, this sounds like the same kind of dismissal he faced nearly a century ago. They argue that his device might have exploited quantum resonance or cosmic radiation in ways science still does not understand. But without surviving evidence, such theories remain speculation. Moray's story reflects the paradox of innovation. He stood between two worlds, one driven by scientific proof and another by visionary intuition. His inability to bridge them left his discovery, real or imagined, forever in limbo. If his device truly worked, it could have transformed civilization. If it did not, it still symbolizes humanity's endless hunger to transcend its limits. Either way, his life embodies both the promise and peril of pursuing the impossible.